conversation with him about reducing it, and it can definitely be reduced, so don't stress about that. I will inform you after I've had the meeting with him to what extent it will be reduced. But I can tell you the exam will be very focused, not covering all the material, and I will give you a very detailed list of what you need to study, and it will be much less than the full textbook and so forth. So these are just preliminary things that he said I should just mention to you. The first reduction, for instance, is that there is no homework today. So there's no homework in this possible lecture. It is possible. I will only release those that is applicable for the exam, because I want to reuse some of the assignments for next year. So, but the ones that will be in the exam, I will definitely release to you so that you can study. As I said, I will go through the list of things you need to study for the exam. The other thing that I do need to just mention is that you also told me that so the way that I originally set up the exam is not going to be like that anymore, because the theoretical written exams should be 50% of the total of your total mark. So, but I will communicate the changes to you after I had a proper meeting with you in which we set all of this in place. But so the way that the exam was presented at the beginning of the year is will change, but for the better for you guys, and the workload will be reduced. So that's all I had to announce. Okay.
You measure how far your needles went on your dials, and you work out X. And then when you make a larger pool, since you know X and you measure the dials, you know approximately how much, how many tons of dynamite your atomic bomb corresponds to. Now you might also notice that their calibration is probably very poor because they reported 20 kilotons and they calibrated with only 100 tons. So they were actually extrapolating way out of the calibration range. That's okay for atomic weapons because close enough is considered good enough. That's not okay for an interferometer, which is why they have more sophisticated measurement equations. But in terms of the philosophy of what's going on, it's exactly the same thing with raising interferometry, except, you know, less spectacular. So the raising interferometer measurement equation, this was formulated by these fine gentlemen in 1996, then reformulated by Hammer-Gren 1000. And basically, so forget everything you learned about interferometry for now, let's just step back and think about what it is that the antenna and the telescope actually measures when you point it up at the sky. And the measurement equation is basically a mathematical description of this process. And once you've got that description, you know what you've measured, you know how to calibrate that measurement, you know how to correct those measurements. And there's a lot of correction going on, which I'll talk about later. So for starters, let's go back to, sorry about those equations, I messed up. Go back to the basics, right? We're measuring electromagnetic plane waves. Have you guys done polarization, polarized signals?
Unfortunately, we haven't touched on
that. I mean, outside the scope. Just being the problem in physics. Yes? No? Well, it doesn't matter. So the basics are not terribly complicated, right? You've got your incoming electromagnetic field. We've talked about this before, right? It's a plane wave, so you can describe it by a vector at the point where you're measuring it, for example. And that vector evolves as a function of time. So if you happen to have a perfectly linearly polarized, monochromatic, that's very important, single frequency plane wave, what you're going to see as the signal passes through, you're going to see it make a perfect sine wave, up and down on one plane, right? That's a perfectly linearly polarized signal. Right? And this box here, I stole this picture from Wikipedia. What this cube here represents is that anywhere else along that plane of measurement, here's the wave coming through, anywhere else you're going to measure that same vector going up and down in a perfect sine wave, in a perfect orderly manner. Right? Then there's something called circularly polarized, a perfectly circularly polarized plane wave. If you look at the vector doesn't go up and down, it just rotates around, makes a perfect circle. That's what's called the circularly polarized field. So the important thing is that the field, the electromagnetic field at the moment you measure, it can be described by a complex two vector, Ex and Ey, and there's no Z component to the field. That's what makes the plane wave. It's just a vector in this plane of measurement. Either it's going up or down, or it's a circle. Right? Now, signals like this, waves like this, you're only ever going to see in the laboratory. Right? You need like filters and lasers and whatnot to make waves that actually look like this. Why does this happen? Well, why don't we see such signals in nature? The way I like to think about it, my intuition for it is, you know, any physical process out there in the universe and its radiation, you've covered the mechanisms of radio emission, whether it's synchrotron or thermal or whatnot, right? You've got, say for example, you've got an electron emitting a photon due to its interaction with the magnetic field, right? That photon is going to correspond to a single energy, so it's going to be a particular wavelength is going to be monochromatic. And depending on the process, it might be perfectly polarized. So one photon is like one little packet of something that's monochromatic and possibly polarized, right? But you're not looking at one photon, you're looking at photons from, you know, all these very many electrons, say, in the galactic plane, right? So they're all contributing their little packets of perfectly monochromatic, perfectly polarized light. But what you're seeing a combination of all progress, right? So you've seen complete, complete cacophony, right? You've got basically your vector, your E vector, instead of doing orderly up and down motions, it's waving around completely randomly. But the important thing is there's still no Z component. It's a plane wave. So it's waving around randomly, but at least it's only waving randomly in this plane. And the other important thing is the vector is still the same across the entire plane. That's, again, that's what makes the plane wave. So if you measure it here and if you measure it here, it's random, but at least it's doing the same thing. Right? That's what, if you think about it, eventually that's what makes the ground force. And, well, if it's random, how can we talk about intensity and polarization? Well, turns out we can define things like intensity and polarization in a statistical sense. Right. So, if you get a perfectly polarized signal, you can say, well, here's my intensity, it's the amplitude of the signal, right? And here's my polarization, it's this plane. You don't have that, you've got your random signal, so you define intensity in terms of statistics. So you say, you define intensity, I, as this component of the plane wave times its complex conjugate, averaged over time, plus this component of the wave times its conjugate, averaged over time. So if you do that, you have a well-defined quantity, and that's actually, again, I think I talked about this in an introductory lecture, when you're detecting signal, right, you're looking at me right now, your eyes are sensitive to this bit, right? They're not actually detecting electromagnetic. You know, the cells in your eyes aren't measuring electromagnetic vectors, they're measuring total power over some average interval, right? And that was what we designate binaural brackets. Same thing with the digital camera, right? You click the shutter is open for some time, which you've measured at each pixel is a statistical average. For total intensity, it's the sum of the averages of the two components of the incoming wave, right? And for polarization, you can combine these components in different ways, and that allows you to define polarization. So these things are called the Stokes parameters, right? So the Q Stokes parameter is the average of X minus the average Y. So if your signal was completely unpolarized, again, remember, it's a random vector, it's going all over the place, so you can think of the angle brackets as actually as an expectation operator. So if your signal was completely unpolarized, you'd have your random vector everywhere, and you would be just as likely to find it pointing in this direction as in this direction, right? So these two quantities would be the same, Q would be zero. If you had a signal that was polarized in Q, then, you know, you would still see a random signal, but it would be slightly more likely to be here than here. So when you do the average, you're going to find that this component is larger than this component, and that's when we say the signal has a positive Q. For you, you take the cross averages. I'll have another diagram in a second, which hopefully explains this. And for V, you take this quantity. So Q and U, as it turns out, Q and U describe the linear polarization of the signal, and V describes the circular polarization of the signal. And typically these things are, pretty much by definition, these things are Q, U, and V are all smaller than I, total intensity. So if you have an unpolarized signal, you have a total intensity of something. And that's when we talk about Jansky's and whatnot. You know, we say this source is an I of one Jansky. We're saying the average of this power is one Jansky. And Q, U, and V would be zero for an unpolarized source. For a slightly polarized source, you would have Q, U, or V, some small number that's generally smaller than I, right? So you have a small polarized fraction. And the reason this happens in nature is because, for example, you've got a magnetic field that the signal is traveling through. So that magnetic field imparts a preferred direction on where the, you know, in which direction the wave evolves. So you measure these things and you find your wave slightly more likely to be in one direction than the other, and then you say, okay, I have a fraction of Q, that's 5%, for example. Here's another diagram, again from Wikipedia, so check the article. If you have an X and Y coordinate system, then positive Q simply means that your entire signal is waving in this plane, if you have 100% Q. So if Q is equal to I, that means all of the signal is polarized along this plane, the x direction. And if Q is 100% of I negative, then the signal is actually, the wave is moving around in this plane. If it's U positive, it's in this diagonal plane. If it's U negative, it's in this plane, right? If you have a perfectly circularly polarized signal, remember that's when the vector waves around in perfect circles, then it's waving either counterclockwise or clockwise, and that corresponds to positive or negative U. So these, the red lines represent what perfectly polarized signals look like. Now, imperfectly polarized signals are, you know, you can think of the vector as describing some sort of ellipse, for example. So again, I've said this before, I'll repeat it, it's an important point. Partially polarized signal simply means that your vector is tends to wave in one direction slightly more than the other. That's all polarization is. It's a kind of asymmetry in what the electromagnetic field is doing. Right? So this brings us to Jones' calculus, invented by optics people. The result will be very useful for radio interferometry. So imagine we've got some signal leaving our source, that signal say over there, and here's the signal the particle traveling towards us. It's a plane wave, so as I've mentioned many times before, since it's a plane wave, you describe it in terms of Ex and Ui, right? Those two vectors, instantaneously. Right? And then on its way to us, the signal passes through something. Cloud of electrons, the Earth's atmosphere, something in your receiver, anyway, something happens to the signal. So your vector goes from being EXEY to EX prime EY prime. Right? And to get the measurement equation, all we do is we assume that whatever happens to the signal is linear. And fortunately, the universe obliges by being mostly linear. And if things weren't linear, it would be in a lot of trouble. It's hard enough to calibrate even with a linear assumption. But basically, if you just make the simple assumption that whatever happened to the signal happens to be a linear operation, then from basic linear algebra, you know that all linear operations on a two-vector can be described by a 2x2 complex matrix, right? So this means that anything linear, that's any linear process that's happened to your signal on its way to you, any linear process has a corresponding 2x2 matrix, which perfectly describes mathematically how that vector was transformed by this instrumental effect. And this is what we call the Jones matrix, J. And basically, as a matrix equation, you can write it like this. So E is a column vector, then J is a matrix, then the prime is your other column vector. So, well, what happens if your signal passes through two bits of something? Well, pretty much the same thing, right? You've got a cloud of electrons here, a cloud of electrons here. Something linear happens here, something linear happens here. You can describe one effect by a Jones matrix, you can describe the other effect by a Jones matrix, and you end up with an equation that looks like this. So you're just taking these 2x2 matrices and you're applying them to the vector, and that's what happens to the signal on its way to you. This much, right? That's very simple, and this is what we call a Jones chain, right? Because you can stack up more things here, and all you do is you're adding 2x2 matrices to this equation. Okay, then something else happens. After all that, the signal finally hits our antenna. And once it hits antenna, it's gathered up and it gets into a receiver. And at some point, the signal gets converted into a pair of voltages. Right? And we can actually describe these things as complex voltages, two complex polarizations. Typically, every dish will have two polarized receivers, for example, X and Y, two linearly polarized receivers, or two circularly polarized receivers of the opposite signal. And that's because the radio interferometer always gathers not just the total intensity information, but the polarization information. So in your dish, you're going to have two receivers, the incoming field is going to induce two voltages. Now again, we just assume that this process is linear. Basically, we trust engineers to build linear system for us, linear systems for us. It can be quite difficult, but you know, they wouldn't do it well. So basically, you can actually write a voltage that's measured at the receiver. You can write it in terms of, again, a two-by-two matrix. So you've got your signal, and the signal is subject to different effects. Each effect has its own little Jones matrix. And of course, the product of 2x2 matrices is just a 2x2 matrix. So you can collapse all these Jones matrices. If you know them, you can collapse them into a single matrix here. So that's your basic equation for voltage. Of course, what we measure with the parameter, and we'll get to that in a second, first I want to talk about what these Jones matrices look like, right? So I said a 2x2 matrix. Well, what kind of matrix? Well, different effects respond to different matrices. So, for example, the most simple effect, what we call the K-Jones, if the signal is propagating through free space, just because it's free space doesn't mean that nothing happens to it. In fact, what happens is the phase of the signal changes, right? The wave, you know, your wave waves up and down, for example, as it propagates through free space. So if it's in one phase here, it's going to be in a different phase over here. And the way to describe that is through a diagonal matrix where you have a complex component. And tau here, tau is the path length that the signal can travel from, and lambda is the wavelength. So basically, this is the phase delay that the signal incurs as it travels over a path of tau in free space. This is the most, pretty much the most simple Jones matrix you can have. This is what we call a scalar matrix, because it's a diagonal matrix that has the same number on the diagonal. So we can actually write it like that in shorthand. It basically corresponds to multiplying each component of the vector by this. And in very many ways, this matrix does behave as a scalar. So we call these things scalar matrices, and we usually write them with we write matrices in bold font, and we write scalar matrices in blue font to emphasize that. Right? Then you might have something else. You might have rotation of the signal, right? And for example, something called parallactic angle rotation. Well, you're not actually rotating the signal, but you're rotating your antenna, because your antenna is fixed to the Earth. So as the Earth rotates, the sky rotates relative to the Earth overhead. So your signal, you define it in the frame of the sky. If you look at what's happening to the signal in the frame of the antenna, because the sky is rotating through an angle of gamma, you can describe, essentially it's like a coordinate transform from the sky frame to the antenna frame, and that you can describe by your standard rotation matrix. Right? Looks like this. Then you have things like, as the signal travels through the ionosphere, it incurs something called ionospheric phase delay, which we describe by the Zeta Jones matrix. It looks like this. It's very similar to this matrix because it's a very similar effect. It's just a phase delay. But that phase delay is given by something called the total electron content divided by frequency. Right? So at high frequencies, the ionosphere is less important. At low frequencies, the ionosphere becomes very important because of this phase delay. And that's why low frequency radio astronomy is a tricky thing to calibrate. Right? Another thing that happens in the ionosphere is something called Faraday rotation. Okay. And Faraday rotation was discovered by Faraday. In the lab, you can see it as rotation of a polarized signal. Right? So if in the lab you make a perfectly polarized signal, for example, linearly polarized, and it's coming through like this, and then you stick a magnetic field, you make it pass through a strong magnetic field, you're actually going to see that your signal that was polarized like this has rotated. It's now polarized in this way. Right? That's called Faraday rotation. The same thing happens, in fact, even if the signal is unpolarized, it still happens, because basically your little E vector rotates through an angle given by something called the rotation measure. It's just that if you don't actually have polarization, if you weren't measuring polarization, you wouldn't see this effect. because you know you're not measuring the statistical properties of the vector. But anyway, so that's another kind of Jones matrix, and this is one that's quite important when we do polar imaging and dating the problems. Other kinds of Jones matrices, well, receiver gains. So, as I said, a receiver has two simplest receivers, a pair of dipoles. One is measuring one component of the field, the other one is measuring another component, and then there's little amplifiers. The signal turns into voltages, there's little amplifiers attached to the wires. Those amplifiers are going to have slightly different gains. And that can be described by a matrix we call G-Jones, and that's probably going to be the mainstay of the calibration exercise for the matrix, because this is usually by far the biggest effect in the problem. The fact that you have your receptors have slightly different sensitivity, and the X receptor will be differently sensitive from the Y receptor, and that's described by a diagonal matrix like this. This, of course, this sensitivity is usually a function of both time and frequency for different reasons. And it's quite common to, it can be quite convenient. It turns out that you can often split this G-Jones into a product of two effects, a frequency-dependent one and a time-dependent one. And this is what we usually call the bandpass, the B. So this thing is frequency-dependent but does not change over time. And this G here is time-dependent, but evolves rather rapidly, but does not vary in frequency. And these are complex numbers, by the way, right? So your receiver in your antenna, it both has an amplitude defined by sensitivity and a phase, the imparts phase offset. Other Jones matrices, you have things like E Jones and then primary beam. I'll show what that looks like a little later in the lecture. D Jones, what we call polarization leakage. All these other matrices were nicely diagonal, so signals from the two polarization fields did not interfere with each other. Everything that went into here, we measured here, everything that went into here, we measured here. In practice, you usually have leakages. There can be electrical leakages between the two receivers, or there can even be just a misalignment, which means that you're measuring the signal associated with one polarization, a little bit of that is measured in another channel. So all these kinds of things, and basically what we do then when we want to calibrate, we say, okay, let's make a model of our instrument and let's put in all the Jones matrices that we think are significant. Oftentimes, this is kind of the most complete Jones chain probably that you can imagine. It's got all the effects listed in it. Oftentimes, you don't put all of these in because they might be, negligible. Like for example, like I said, the ionosphere, because the effect of the ionosphere decreases as a function of frequency. At high frequency, people don't worry about the ionosphere, so they don't worry about these materials. Things like that. So, but basically this is your kind of your general Jones chain. And the important thing to note here is that, of course, matrices don't commute, right? In general, matrix multiplication does not commute. You cannot just swap them around and get the same result. So when you write your Jones chain, you have to write it in exactly the same order that the signals appear in the signal chain. And this is why it's written in this order. Remember, the original signal is here, and the measured signal is here, right? So you've got your original signal. Well, what happens to it first? The ionosphere. Then you have parallactic angle translating into the antenna frame. Geometric delay is here, but it doesn't have to be here. I'll show why in a second. Primary beam, sensitivity, polarization leakage, and then you have your electronic gains and amplifiers. So this kind of more or less corresponds to the order of the effects. And the reason it's important to write it in that order is because matrices don't commute, right? But more also important, we do know that specific matrices do commute. So, for example, scalar matrices, like K-Jones, they commute with anything, any other matrix. So this K here, you can actually move anywhere else to the chain, and that's not going to change the result. We also know that diagonal matrices commute among themselves. So, for example, B and G can be swapped here. We know that dissertation means commute. So if you have dissertation here and dissertation here, change them around and change the result. So this is kind of a, what this is really, you know, you don't have to remember all these details. This is just a specific example. But what it shows is that you have this matrix framework for reasoning about what happens to your signal as you measure it. And you can apply some very specific mathematical rules to manipulate these things. So why do we need this? Well, because we are, as you can see from this chain, what gets to our antennas is actually a corrupted signal. Right? It's been modified by all these different drone matrices. So if you want to reconstruct the sky, we actually want to be able to unroll all these effects and get at the original signal. So how do we do this? Well, drone's calculus lets us construct a full, kind of a full model of what's happening to the signal. And then we can basically correct for these things. We can invert the matrix, we can apply them to the signal, and do correction. And the reason we can do that is because some of these things we know perfectly well a priori. So things like, for example, parallactic angle, that's just a geometric effect. We know exactly what angle of the sky is. So this thing we know, right? Things like K, geometric delay, I'll talk about that a little later, and that's the difference in the path length between two dishes. That also we know perfectly well, provided we know where the dishes are, which we know to a very high precision. So some of these things are known perfectly. Other things we need to solve for. Right? Remember that little x we had to solve for in the case of the atomic bomb. Same here, you have to solve for these things using some sort of known measurements. And that's what calibration is all about. And you'll learn about that in further lectures. And linear algebra, you need linear algebra because it tells you how you can optimize and simplify this equation. You know, once you know linear algebra, you can start committing these terms and writing out calibration equations. Anyway, that was Jones' calculus. Of course, what we're measuring with interferometer, again, aren't actually the voltages. The voltages, they're somewhere in the antenna, and they vary quite rapidly, as you can imagine. You know, if you're talking about gigahertz signals, that means your voltages are actually changing on that time scale, right? Billions of times per second. So what you as a user of the interferometer get aren't actual voltages, that would be far too much data, be far too much confusing. What you actually get are correlations. Right? So you've got your two voltages, so we'll designate antennas by P and Q. You have antenna P here, you have antenna Q here. And this one registers a pair of voltages. Remember, this is complex to vector. This one registers a pair of voltages. And then these voltages go into this big box of wires in the electronics called the correlator. And essentially, all the correlator does is it's both a very simple and a very sophisticated device. It's very simple because what it computes is actually very simple. It just takes the pairwise product. It takes, remember, this is a vector and this is a vector. So it takes the first pair of voltages, one times conjugate to other, averages. It gives you a single number. It takes the second pair, takes the product, and takes the two cross pairs. So basically it's taking these voltages, which remember change very rapidly, gigahertz, terahertz, whatever, and it's turned them into correlations. And correlations, because they are averages over some interval, which can be, you know, a second, 5 seconds, suddenly you have far fewer numbers to deal with. And this is the numbers that actually come out of this box. This is what the interferometer produces. So let's see what these numbers represent. So remember, your original signal was called E. Your original signal was the same, right? Before it hit the two antennas. But on the way to the two antennas, different things happened to it, right? Because, you know, the antennas are separated, so it had to pass through different bits of the atmosphere. The antennas have different electronics. So you have basically two different drones matrices, which describe this signal path and this signal path. So if you write this out, now you get into some very simple linear algebra. So it turns out that these four numbers, these four pairwise correlations that correlate to computes, it's quite convenient to arrange them into a matrix. Why? Because then you can represent this operation as a matrix product. You take your first pair of voltages from the first antenna, you take the conjugate transpose, what's called the Hermitian transpose, of the second pair of voltages, and then if you just take the matrix product of these two, and then take the average over time, and frequency implicitly, I'll talk about that also, then you end up with this matrix of four correlations, right? And the factor of two is in there just for convenience. You can look at the papers to figure out what it is. It's just to make things line up. Just by definition, we put two here. So this is just a mathematical trick, a mathematical convenience. We say a correlator measures the matrix product of one voltage vector times the complex conjugate of the other vector. Why it becomes important? Well, let's bring Jones matrix into the mix. You've got one voltage is original signal times Jp, the other voltage is original signal times Jq. So if you put that into the previous equation, you end up with this. Now the Hermitian conjugate of Ab is B conjugate A conjugate, right? So using this, you end up with an equation like this. You start with the two voltages, you express the voltages in terms of the original signal. So you end up with one Jones matrix, then you have two times the product of the signal with itself, and then you have the other Jones matrix. And there is kind of a big assumption here. When we do this averaging operator, we can be actually assuming that the Jones matrices don't change over the time that we are averaging over. And if they don't change, then we are entitled to do this, right? So does everyone agree with this model? It's very, very straightforward.
I just have a question. From the previous slide, the signal, the E, not this one. Yeah. The ones that have multiple zones.
Yeah. But?
Yeah, this one. The, we concentrate on the J's, the number of J's you use here, the Jones.
We concentrate on the J's. Yes, if you want to describe the measurement, we concentrate on the J's.
Okay, and then the E is only one. That's the...
Well, the E... So the E is kind of the... You know, the E is instantaneous. Right? Remember, the field is the electromagnetic field, the plane wave is an evolving thing, right? So the E is constantly waving around as a function of time. But if you fix one instant in time, you have an instantaneous E, and then if you fix the voltage at that point in time, you have an instantaneous voltage. And the relationship between them is described by this chain of Jones matrices. And this is why it's actually important that the Jones matrices don't change too much at the function of time, because some small interval of time later, your E is something completely different and your voltage is something completely different. But this relationship still holds, right? The Jones matrices haven't changed. So your E is doing something crazy, your V is doing something crazy, but these things are not, you know, disconnected. They are perfectly connected by the Jones chain. But because, you know, what we're interested in are properties of E. I'll show that in a second. You'll see the Stokes parameters emerge. What we're actually measuring in the interferometer is in antenna is the V. We can't measure the original E. We need to construct a device, that's the antenna, that's the receiver, and then we measure V. So the point of all this is to relate the V we've measured to the E that we are interested in. But relate in a statistical sense, because this E, remember, is noise. And then in a statistical sense, it says the Jones parameters, because that's the next slide. So we got to this part. Our four correlations are a Jones matrix for one antenna, a product of the signal with itself, averaged over time and frequency, and a Jones matrix for the other antenna. And now, if you remember the Stokes parameters that we defined at the beginning of the lecture, this product of the signal with itself is actually pretty much exactly what the Stokes parameters are, this bit is missing the angle brackets. Now remember, total intensity is defined as Ex times Ex conjugate plus Ey times Ey conjugate. That's I. Q is defined as the difference between these two. So Ex times Ex is actually I plus Q twice, right? 2 times I plus Q, and Ey times Ey is I minus Q. So this is something we call the brightness matrix. Right. And the brightness matrix is a 2x2 matrix that describes the signal power and polarization, and basically it contains exactly the same information as the four Stokes parameters. It tells you everything about the statistical properties of the signal. Notice that time has disappeared from here, right? In a sense. So your original field vector was doing random zigzagging, right? The Stokes parameters describe that random zigzagging statistically. The Stokes parameters say this is the average amplitude, this is the average difference between amplitudes, etc., etc. So you've got your V, and this V is actually what we want to measure, right? This is what we want to know. If you're looking at the source in the sky, we want to know what the total power is coming from that source. We want to know what the polarization properties are, if you're interested in polarization. So this is our astrophysical measurable. This is what we want to establish. And the most basic rhyme, the most basic measurement equation basically tells us that the underlying astrophysical signal, B, the brightness matrix, is related to the four correlations produced by the interferometer by this very simple equation. There's a Jones matrix here, there's a Jones matrix here, and you take the product of the three, and that tells you what your measurement looks like. So the process of calibration is basically inverting this equation, right? Because we've measured this. Now we want to figure out what the J's are, so we can correct for them and get back the original B. And B is where the science is. So another way to look at this, and this is where Jones calculus begins to come in so handy, something called the Einion form of the rhyme. So remember, this Jones matrix, this J, describes everything that's happened to the signal, all the different effects compounded. And that's what we call a Jones chain, right? You can decompose it into, because there are physically different things happening to the signal, you can decompose this overall effect into individual effects. Right? And then when you put that into the measurement equation, you get something like this. This is what I call the Einion form, because you take your B, your source brightness, and then you start applying layers of signal corruptions to it. Another round before we get into the details, just in terms of terminology, right? So what everything I've described above is called the rhyme, the measurement equation. So that's like the general mathematical formalism for talking about the deformation. That's the measurement equation. And when we're actually calibrating the measurement, we take some specific Jones terms. We take the important ones, like the ones that are non-negligible. And we construct a measurement equation, a rhyme. So for example, if you're just looking at the single point source, if the sky contains nothing else except the point source, and we decide to ignore all other effects except receiver gains, then we have a measurement equation that looks like this. We've only got brightness in here. We've only got phase delay, which corresponds to the propagation difference to the two antennas. And we've got the gains here, which correspond to the gains of the two receivers. That's kind of almost the most simplest measurement equation you can have. Well, you can actually have an even simpler one. If you assume your receiver is absolutely perfect, so a unity input signal gives you a unity voltage, then you can write a rhyme like this. This is kind of the rhyme of a perfectly ideal instrument. But K-Jones never goes away, right? Because K-Jones is just the phase delay of the signal as it propagates through the free space. So because it has to propagate through different paths before it gets to two antennas, there's always going to be a k here associated with one antenna and with the other antenna. So let's see, I just want the numbers for a break. So this is where we have the one complicated diagram. This is a good one to remember because it basically defines the standard coordinate system for interferometric measurements. So let's say we have that perfect interferometer described by this equation. So there's nothing in here except k. What does the k equals 2? We can unpack it a little bit. So let's say we've got here S is where our source is. Well, S is a particular direction from which the signal arrives. We pick a coordinate axis, Z. And then we pick X and Y in a plane orthogonal to Z. X is east and Y is north. Then in that coordinate system, the positions of the antennas we can define by two vectors called UP and UQ, right? That's just where our antennas are in a chosen coordinate frame. And then UPQ is what we call the baseline. That's the difference between the two antennas, right? So and just imagine two signals. You've got, say, one signal coming from along the z-axis. So from this point, it's not here. That's your wavefront sigma naught. And then there's another signal coming from along this axis, from point S. And the vector sigma naught and the vector sigma is a unit vector pointing towards the source from which the signal is coming from. So this is sigma naught pointing at the along there, and this is sigma point point S. And here I've got, and I schematically represent the wavefront corresponding to the vector sigma naught and the wavefront corresponding to the vector sigma. Right? Now, once you've drawn all this, you can see what the path length difference is, right? So the difference in the path that the signal has to travel between antenna P and antenna Q is going to be tau naught for this direction, and it's going to be tau for this direction. Right? And what is that path length difference? Like, what is tau equal to? That's actually quite easy to work out. It's just, you know, this is just straightforward geometry. This is just this scalar product, this product here, this dot product. It's basically the dot product between the UPQ vector and the sigma vector, the direction of propagation. So that's this dot product here. Now, if you remember, an even better trick perhaps is to take the difference in path length relative to zero, to the coordinate point, to the chosen coordinate point. So the difference between antenna P and zero is UP dot product sigma over wavelength times 2pi. Right? So this here is just your excess path. And then this corresponds to the phase of the signal in the curve of that excess path, right, the complex component. Same thing you can write for Q, and then if you take the product of those two complex exponents, you end up with this, which is just the dot product of UPQ times the parabola vector. Is that clear? It takes a lot of staring at this diagram for all this to become clear, but it's useful reference point to come back. And I'm not sure I want to talk about averaging before taking the break first. So let's have a 5 or 10 minute break. 5 minute break.
Thank you.
this point, they would be commented, or if you commented a little part that you had the same plus string of that bit, and plus, so then you have this variable, and this variable you change before you have the rate or the name, and then put this number from 1 to 100, then it goes through the first, and it takes it and puts it in this thing, wherever it's going to change, reads it into your file, and I guess you can append it somewhere. You just run all the listings and all of them.
What happens if the take the average of a rotating vector. You can kind of already see it in this diagram. There is a bit of code in the lecture notes that lets you play with these diagrams. When a complex vector rotates and you take its average, what you actually see is a decrease in amplitude. Right? Well, in fact, if you take an average of a complex vector while it has rotated a full turn, the average is just going to be zero. Right? If you take an average of a smaller interval, then the amplitude doesn't go to zero, but it decreases by some noticeable amount. And this is what's known as time and frequency smearing in interferometry. And basically, well, the question is, what do we do with smearing? There's not much we can do, right? Because intrinsically, you have to accumulate an average signal. You have to average over some amount of time to A, to reduce the data rates, B, to compute the average quantity in the first place. Right? So we have to average over time. We also have to average over frequency. The correlator gives you an output per channel, so it's averaged over small frequency bits. But we cannot make those bits arbitrarily small, because that would require arbitrarily large computing power to produce that many numbers. So whatever we're doing in the interferometry, we're always averaging in time and frequency. So something like this is always going to happen. We can try to do the next best thing. We can try to minimize this effect. And how do we minimize this effect? Well, we make sure that the phase changes as little as possible over the average in time. And there is a simple trick to doing that. So let's say this is our source of interest. It's not. Let's see how I can mention this the best. Basically, what we want to do is we want to make sure that if this is the direction we're looking at, and let's say this is the source we're trying to map out, what we want to do is we want to make sure that for a signal arriving from this region, let's say from the center, or from this region, that the phase changes as little as possible, as a function of time and frequency. And basically what we do this through something called fringe stopping. Now think of it this way, right? Let's pick this direction, S naught. Right? So this is our signal arriving from S naught. This is our delta P, this is our delta Q. There's going to be a path length difference of tau naught. So there is going to be a phase delay corresponding to tau naught over lambda. So if you change frequency, the phase is going to change. Right? The phase is going to change depending on how many wavelengths there are in this tau naught. So there's a trick we do directly in the correlator. What if we just include electronically a delay corresponding to tau naught in the correlator? If in the electronics we artificially delay the signal by tau naught, then there isn't going to be any phase difference between the two dishes for this particular direction. And that means when you change frequency, because there's no phase difference to begin with, you've artificially compensated for tau naught, you've made the delay zero. This means that in this direction, S naught, in direction Z, the phase is not going to change as a function of frequency. But as soon as you go away from this direction, you know, the delay becomes tau as opposed to tau naught, and now of course it's going to change because you're compensating for tau naught, but you're not compensating for tau. But it's going to change by far less of a, it's going to change far less than if you didn't do this trick to begin with, right? If you didn't do this trick of electronically compensating for the phase delay in the correlator, then the phases from here would rotate a lot more than they do if you compensate for the center of the field. And mathematically, this is very easy to express, right? All we want to do is we want to Basically, we want to set the phase corresponding to this direction, sigma naught. The unit vector pointing at z is 0, 0, 1. This is the corresponding phase, so L is 0, M is 0, N is 1. We want to artificially set the space to 0. So that means all we have to do is insert the phase delay in the correlator corresponding to this term, right? For sigma 0, 0, 1, this is equal to this. And this is what's called bridge-stopping. So in real life, when we observe, the correlator is always doing this for you. You pick a direction that you want to observe in, and the correlator compensates in that direction to make sure that phase changes as little as possible. And what this means is because the original signal had this phase delay, right? And then the correlator has compensated, has added minus this phase delay. This means when you take a product of the two phase delays, you end up, instead of this, you end up with this. So this is what K-Jones looks like for a fringe-stopping correlator. And all correlators these days are fringe-stopping, precisely because we want to avoid this effect of smearing. We want to make sure phases change as little as possible. So it's a lot of trickery in electronics. It's a lot of, there have to be accurate delay models and whatnot. This thing is quite difficult for the engineers to set up. For us, as the observers, the only thing we need to know is that our K-Jones, our phase, becomes this, n minus 1 instead of this. So it's a whole long story I gave you, but you know, this is what I was trying to get at. The phase in the measurement equation for a fringe-stopping correlator is n minus 1 and not n. So given all this, we're kind of sort of ready to go to the whole sky measurement equation. So this equation is extremely simplified. Why? Because we are actually assuming here a single source. We're assuming a single source for the brightness of B. So we're assuming a completely empty sky, one source for the brightness of B, and we're writing this equation. Of course, this is a simplification. In real life, the sky is an image, right? So the B matrix isn't actually one single matrix in one single direction. The B matrix is a function, and it's a function of direction, which we designate by sigma. So sigma is the direction vector. So B of sigma is essentially the brightness image, the image in the sky that we want to observe, that we want to recover. So what is it we actually measure when brightness is not a single source but a whole distribution as functional direction? Well, you've got an image, you can think of every pixel, every source of that image as a separate little B, and then the path from each source is also going to be different, right? Depending on whether it came from there, the signal will have traveled through, again, different atmosphere, different whatnot. So the Jones matrix for the signal coming from direction sigma is also a function of sigma. So basically, when you put it all together, what you're seeing on the output of your instrument is actually an integral over. If you had a single source, you would just have JP, B, JQ, H as before. But now, because you're observing a sky, you're observing a brightness distribution in the sky, what you have to do in principle, you have to take this distribution of brightness and Jones matrix over the entire sky and integrate over the entire sky. Because in principle, if you just stick an antenna on the ground, it's actually going to sum a signal from the entire sky. So if you want to write the full measurement equation, you have to write it like this. This is a two-dimensional integration over a sphere, over the entire sphere. So this is kind of quite intractable to work with. No one likes integrals to find over a sphere and whatnot. So we try to simplify that. And the first way to simplify that is to...
Integrating over the whole sphere, so I'm assuming that's the celestial sphere.
Yeah.
But at any second, your antennas will only be looking at half of this at least, because you've got the ground in your way.
Yeah, so one way to think of that...
24-hour integration, essentially.
No, this is instant. This you can think of as an instantaneous, because all these things change the function of time. Mm-hmm. But what you're saying is essentially that the Jones matrix is zero for the whole hemisphere.
No, what I'm saying essentially is that you're integrating over the entire sphere. We're measuring V.
Yeah.
So
the V you measure is...
We only seeing half of this entire sphere because we're on the planet.
Yes, the rest is orbit, but right, the
so, and in those moments you've got your Jones matrices to be zeros.
Those matrices. Yes, that's the way to think of it. So, effectively it's only a hemisphere because J is zero in another hemisphere. And that's actually exactly why where the next equation comes in. Because of this, you can think of just the top hemisphere. Now you can simplify things a little bit by taking the top hemisphere and projecting that onto a plane. Then instead of integrating over a hemisphere, you're integrating over a plane, and integrating on the plane is a bit easier. So now instead of working on a sphere, we work on what we call the LM plane. And of course, when you change coordinates on integration, you have to put this term in, right? Your integration volume changes. This is just basic mathematics. So this projection term basically turns out to be equal to n. And all this says is that, you know, if you've got some brightness here, like say the disk of unity brightness here projects onto the same kind of brightness on the plane, but if you've got that same disk here on the horizon, it projects onto something that's very small on the plane, but its overall density actually increases, right? If you've got some amount of flux coming from here on the sphere, once you project it onto a plane, you have to still have to have the same amount of flux out on a smaller object. So that's what the projection thing does. That's the geometric way to think of it. But in fact, this is just standard change of coordinates and integration, as one of red. So anyway, we've gone from a sphere to a hemisphere to a plane. So that's a bit easier. Now look at the Jones matrices. Now the thing to realize is that each Jones matrix is a chain, and a chain of effects that happen on different bits of the signal path, and some of these things are going to depend on direction, and some aren't. So for example, things like your atmosphere obviously does depend on direction, right? But things like your antenna gain, receiver gain, does not, because that effect arises on the signal path after all the signals have always been collected together. So in principle, you can take your Jones chain, and it's convenient to write it out like this. We split it up into three parts. What we call G, using the symbol G again, repurposing it to take the direction-independent part. Then we take the term E as a function of Ln. This is all the Jones matrices that have a direction dependence. And then we take the K, the phase delay. The phase delay is also obviously direction-dependent. Remember, it's an exponent with Ln eminent. But it's scalar, so we can move it anywhere in the chain, so we put it at the end of the chain here. So this is how we can represent the Jones matrices in the integral. And when we do that, we end up with this equation, right? All I've done here is put the G's and the E's in, and then the G's, because they're directional dependent, we can take them outside the integration. And then inside we have 1 over n that came from projection, we have the sky brightness, we have the Jones matrices, the direction-dependent Jones matrices. And then we have the k's, right? And the k's look like this. And this is beginning to look very much like a Fourier transform, right? This configuration here. And we can make it into a perfect two-dimensional Fourier transform by saying, just formally, this is just a mathematical trick, a two-dimensional Fourier transform would need to have UL times VM and not on none of this WM stuff. So just mathematically we can define a separate Jones matrix formally called WP, which is equal to this one, or square root of n times this exponent. And when we put that matrix into the Jones chain, into the Jones chain, and just absorb it in there, we end up with this. So basically the correlation you have measured for antenna pair P and Q is just a Fourier transform, times the direction-dependent drones of interest. Right? So the direction-dependent ones come in after the Fourier transform. And what RV Fourier transforming is the sky, well, not quite the sky. It's what we call the apparent sky. So it's the sky, there is only one sky, that's the brightness distribution, times the Jones matrix for one antenna, and times the Jones matrix for the other antenna. So, if you simplify things, and if you just assume that all our antennas are completely identical, that maybe there's no ionosphere, so let's assume that these things, EV and EQ, are the same for all antennas. But the system is not perfect. If you have that, then you can basically, or rather, just assume they're unity, assume they don't exist, assume all the effects are direction independent in the G, and this is unity. Then you have the equation simplifies even further to this, right? So basically you have a true two-dimensional Fourier transform of the sky brightness times G Jones per antenna P times G Jones per antenna Q conjugate. And that's kind of, this is a very common form of the measurement equation. This is used in many packages, kind of neglecting all the other finer effects. If you have something like this, then there's a whole process called calibration through which you can estimate these Gs, right? And if you've estimated these Gs, then you can invert them. So you invert them, you multiply your measured correlations by the inverse of these estimated Jones matrices. And then you end up with something we call corrected visibilities. And corrected visibilities are now exactly a Fourier transform of the underlying sky. So now you can do everything you learned about imaging into convolution, right? You've got these corrected visibilities, you can convert them into an image. So that's basically the ideal case, no direction-dependent effects, perfect calibration. You get back to corrected visibilities, which are now a Fourier transform of the sky. Now the problem is, this is where things get subtle, is that direction-dependent effects are actually always present. So, and well, one of the more important ones is the antenna primary V. Right? Your antenna is not uniformly sensitive to the entire hemisphere. It actually has a sensitivity pattern. It has maximum sensitivity where you point at the dish, and then the pattern kind of falls off, and there are side lobes. And so the first assumption you could make, okay, let's say we do have an antenna primary beam, so basically this means that the signal from the field of view is not attenuated, and signals from outside the field of view are attenuated. This is actually a good thing, because this means that if you're only interested in this region of the sky, you only need to image this region of the sky. And the rest of the sky looks empty because the antenna primary beam has attenuated down. So if you assume that this primary beam is the same for every single antenna, and also that it doesn't change in time, then you can actually define something called an apparent sky. Right, we drop the p-index because it's the same across all antennas, we drop the time because it's the same across time, and then you say, okay, we have an apparent sky, we've just taken the sky and we've multiplied it by the sensitivity pattern of our antennas, and that's what we're measuring the Fourier transform of. And in simple observations, this is good enough, and this is what's called the classical regime of interferometry. For tens and tens of years, the only way people did interferometry was by assuming this. And what actually happens, well, eventually this assumption breaks down, but you need a certain amount of sensitivity in an instrument before you actually see things break. If your instrument is not very sensitive, then this assumption is good enough. Why is it good enough? When you get sensitive, this is what the primary beam actually looks like. So this is the sky, this is an actual bit of sky. In orange, I've encoded the sensitivity of the antenna. So the primary beam E is a function of LNL. And you can see, what does it do? It rotates. rotates for the same reason that, as I mentioned earlier, well, the sky is rotating. The Earth is rotating, so the sky is rotating relative to us. So you can think of, in the antenna frame, well, if you look at the antenna from the point of view of the sky, the antenna is actually rotating. So the spectrum is rotating. And what I should have done was given you a picture of an antenna here, of an antenna here. The reason this thing has these asymmetrical lobes is because this is a pattern for a JVLA antenna. And JVLA has these classically designed dishes where you have a, you've got a dish and you've got a secondary mirror in the center and you've got four struts that physically hold up the thing in the middle. And this is what makes for such a sensitivity pattern. These globes here are the result of diffraction of those four feedbacks. So it creates a pattern that's rotationally not symmetric, which is not good, as we see in a second, because it violates that assumption I was talking about. There are two ways to find this. The extensive way is to put the dish on what's called an equatorial mount. So instead of having the dish rotate on an azimuth axis, on an elevation axis, you can actually make one of the rotation axis of the dish parallel to the north-south axis of the Earth. And then what happens then, as you track, the sky does not rotate relative to the dish. So you have this pattern that completely stabilized on the sky, not rotating as you observe. This is what's called an equatorial mount. This has been done for some telescopes in the past. It's very expensive just because the mechanics of constructing this whole tilted thing is just a lot of metal. It's not practical to build something big like Meerkat or the SK with equatorial mounts. The other way to find this pattern is the approach that Meerkat has taken, and that's by doing something called offset Gregorian optics. So instead of having a symmetric system where you have the receiver or a mirror in the middle of the dish, you have a slightly asymmetric system where the signal comes in like this, bounces off the dish onto a secondary, which sits on an arm here, and then into a focus. So it makes for a more, because you don't have anything in the dish obstructing the signal, you don't get this characteristic diffraction pattern. You have a more uniform sensitivity. But you have other problems, which I won't get into today. The point is, this rotation, unless you have an equatorial mount telescope, the sky rotation breaks down this assumption. So it means your primary beam, your E Jones, is not constant in time anymore. Another way in which modern interferometers break the classical interferometry assumption is there's other Jones terms that differ from antenna to antenna. And one of them, for example, is the W Jones that we absorb the W term in. Now remember, if you look back at the diagram, W is just this coordinate. It's the coordinate of the difference between the dishes in the C plane. So if you were to put all your dishes in the single plane, you wouldn't have a W. That's what's called the coplanar array. Unfortunately, again, it's not practical. Right? We have to put our dishes down on the ground, and it rotates around, so our dishes don't stay in the same place. So we have a W term. And that's another thing that violates this assumption. And then you have pure mechanical problems, right? You're moving the dish around to track the source. There's all sorts of mechanical effects, like sag due to gravity. Then maybe some wind comes through and pushes on the dish. So your sensitivity pattern actually goes off a little bit by a fractional amount. And because the dishes are, they're meant to be identical, but of course they aren't. They're each of them perfect. This offset might be different. So in real life, if you start looking at things subtly enough, sensitively enough, you'll see that this assumption in the promontory breaks down. And it does things like, well, what's the effect? Basically, if this is what your sky looks like, this is well, this is actually a radio image of my favorite source, AZ-147. In truth, it looks kind of like this. Now, if you don't correct for the rotation of the sensitivity pattern, for example, these three sources here, they actually look like that. When you take the Fourier transform. And why do they look like that? Well, if I take you back to this animation, you can see that as a function of time, the sensitivity pattern moves over these three sources in particular. For sources over here, it's not that important because this part of the pattern is circular. So the sensitivity of the instrument to these sources does not change that much. But for these sources, it changes as a function of time. It goes up and down. And that's exactly what produces these. If you just take the Fourier transform, because you've taken the Fourier measurements at different points in time, right? You are taking several hours to fill up your visibility plane. In some of these measurements, you're showing these sources appear brighter because the orange spot is passing over them. In some of those measurements, the sources appear fainter. And so when you take the Fourier transform, they don't come out as nice compact little dots anymore. They come out as things like that look like this. And this is the subject of what we call third generation calibration or direction dependent calibration. I don't know if I actually have it in the course.
They don't have practical, they have a few slides in the calibration. Okay. There's no practical.
So this is just basically to give you a flavor of the problem. But 20 years ago, people didn't worry about this. Why? Because the instruments weren't actually sensitive enough. If you observed this field 20 years ago, you would just barely maybe begin to see these sources. And these artifacts around them are, you know, they're an order of magnitude fainter than the sources yet again. So you simply wouldn't see them. You would only see like faint blobs here, and yeah, they're distorted, but so what? You can't see it, you're not sensitive enough. So 20 years ago, this was a perfectly acceptable situation. Now, given how sensitive modern telescopes are, things like the expanded JVLA and Meerkat, this is a problem that needs to be corrected in observations. Okay, that's about, we're coming to the end of the session. The one last thing I wanted to introduce was mirror calculus. And this is basically because if you now go to the papers and the literature and start reading about calibration, you're going to see a lot of things called mirror matrices. And you're going to say, okay, wait a minute, I thought it was Rolle matrices. In fact, it's the same thing, it's just an alternative way of looking at the calibration problem. Okay. So instead of having a 2x2 brightness matrix to describe the source, instead we can take something called the Stokes vector B. So we can take the four Stokes parameters and we can put them into a vector, right? And for each baseline then we can define a measured Stokes vector, which looks like this. So you know, this should look familiar from the other equations because essentially it's the same mathematical relationship. It's the relationship between the Stokes parameters and the measured visibilities. So basically, in the mirror formulation, you say that each baseline is measuring a measured Stokes vector that is somehow corrupted by the instrument. And how is it corrupted by the instrument? Well, again, we assumed everything was linear. I remember in Jones' calculus, we assume everything is linear. So if everything is linear, then what you measure is going to be a linear function of what you put in, the brightness vector. This is a 4 vector, so that means there must be a 4x4 matrix which describes the relationship between the original Stokes parameters and the measured Stokes parameters. And this is what people call the mirror matrix. So this would be the mirror matrix of baseline VQ. And it can be a useful way to think about this problem. It's completely complementary to Jones calculus. It's just a different way of formulating the same thing. And it's useful because it kind of emphasizes the linear relationship. So when people talk about imaging algorithms, they actually usually find it more convenient to write a relationship like this rather than with 2x2 drawn matrices. But in theory, it's quite straightforward to go from one to the other. There's this little mathematical operation called the Kronecker product. Basically, if you have your voltage vector, correlation vector V11, V12, V1, V2, you can express that as an outer product between your voltage vectors. So you have your voltage P1, voltage P2 here, you have your voltage Q1, voltage P2 here. If you take the conjugate of that and take the outer or the Kronecker product, you end up with a stack of four numbers, which is exactly the stack of the four correlations. Right? So this is just a mathematical trick, right? It's nothing fancy about this. By analogy, you can do the same thing with your E vector. You can take the Kronecker product of the E vector itself, multiply it by 2, and you end up with something we call a coherency vector, which is just equal to this. So this is exactly the same numbers as in the 2x2 brightness matrix, just in the 4 vector. And then, if you look up any textbook of linear algebra, you have this mixed product identity, right? The outer product of my matrix products can be expressed as the matrix product of two outer products. So if you write out what the four measured visibilities are, you want to measure correlations, the Kronecker product of the voltages, and each voltage is a Jones matrix times E, right? So you write this, you take the Kronecker product of that, you use this relation, you end up with this, and so you end up with the coherency vector times the outer product of two Jones matrices, the Kronecker product. So that's basically how you go from a Jones formalism to a Müller formalism. So you go from 2x2 matrices into a 4x4 matrix. It's not an arbitrary 4x4 matrix, it's not because it's actually an outer product.
Why do we multiply by 2 there?
Sorry?
Why do we multiply by 2? The visibility.
This is just a convention because if you remember, I is EX times EX plus EY times EY, right? Q is EX times EX minus EY times EY. So I plus Q is 2 times EX times EX. So that's where the 2, we basically take the 2 out. It's actually a good question because you'll see some literature where this factor isn't there. And then that makes for some inconsistency. And that's basically it. So this is the measurement equation in Müller form. You have a coherency vector, you have a correlations vector, and you have a Müller matrix in between. You can also notice that this vector here, it's just a linear function of the Stokes parameters. So there is actually a conversion matrix, which we call S. You can take the Stokes parameters, a vector of Stokes parameters, and you can multiply by this S matrix, and you get the coherency vector. Right? And then there is the inverse of the S matrix, which can take you from the coherency vector to back to Stokes parameters. Right? And so given these S matrices, and given the outer product, you can basically write your entire measurement equation in Müller form like this. You say, well, this is our measured Stokes vector. You need to convert the measured correlations to the Stokes parameters. And then you have this full equation. You have a brightness vector here. So this is IQUV in the source. This is the brightness vector that you measured on baseline PQ. So this is measured IPQ, Q, 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 Q. And they relate to each other like this. You need to take the Kronecker product of the Jones matrices, and you need to apply the conversion matrices from outside of that. So that's basically, that's really formalism, just something useful to know because you will run into this in the literature. So it's a good exercise to be able to go from one to the other. And that's basically it. I think that's all I have for today. Thank you. No homework, unfortunately. I'm sure you all support it.